72-hour study on Doe governorship election. Is INEC ready? And what does the Seyi Makinde camp have to say about tension in the Southwest PDP? This is Plus Politics. I am Kaede Ladeide. Welcome back. It is Plus Politics, and let's go to the straight to the first topic of the day. The Ondo State governorship election has been slated to take place in about 72 hours from now. On the day of the election, it is expected that the people of the Sunshine State will line up to vote for who will sit at the Alagbaka government house in Akure over the next 4 years. However, their efforts and will to vote depends largely on the preparedness of the electoral umpire, which is INEC. So our question today is, how prepared is the Electoral Commission for the Ondo election? Joining us to discuss this is the Chairman, Information and Voter Education Committee of INEC, Mr. Festus Okoye. Good evening, Mr. Okoye. Yeah, I hope I can hear you. Good evening, Mr. Okoye. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you.
Oh, good. Yeah, let's get started with so many issues that we need clarity on. The first has to do with, I remember you said it on this station, but we just need to be updated. When we had about, 5,141 smart cards that we lost to the fire? And we understand that about 5,000 have been brought in from the neighboring state or your state. But how ready are these smart cards? Have they been well configured? Are we not likely to have any issues?
As you pointed out, we lost a total of 5,141 smart card readers to the fire incident that occurred in the in one of the containers in the office of the Independent National Electoral Commission in Ondo State. Now, just 2 days after that particular fire incident, we have vested the smart card readers we have from we have in our Oyo State office and move them straight into Akure. And these smart card readers were poised. They have been properly configured. They have been charged. And they are just waiting for deployment. So by tomorrow, the smart card readers will be deployed for the purposes of the Ondo governorship election. So we have sufficient smart card readers. We have sufficient redundancies. And also, we even have sufficient number with which we carried out the training of supervisory presiding officers and the ad hoc staff for this election.
Okay, quite a lot of issues, so I would not, I would like to ask so many of them. One hallmark, one interesting thing that happened in the last Edo election was the introduction of the Z pads, or what some of us also call the IREV, where you have opportunity of viewing the result at the polling unit. Are we also having something, you know, an improvement on that, or what are we expecting this time?
Definitely, we are going to deploy the Z-pad for the purposes of uploading a polling unit results that is from EC8A into a central portal where Nigerians who are interested can log in and view these results in real time. We introduced it in the Nasarawa Central State Constituency election. We used it during the Edo governorship election, and we are definitely going to also introduce and use it during this Ondo governorship election. So the Z-pad will be introduced, and the Z-pad will be used, and we are going to upload the result, the polling unit results in real time. So definitely the Z-pad will be at play.
Tell me more about these Z-pads. Some people would say, what actually is the difference from what was obtainable? Before now, we have results published at different polling units. Probably, is it just more than manual to electronic? Is there something more we need to know?
Well, you know, before now, Nigerians have complained, and genuinely too, that the result management system has been very, very problematic. Most of them have complained that sometimes the results that are harvested at the polling unit and calibrated into from EC8A are not really the result that gets to the collation centers. For instance, in the in Ondo State, we have 203 electoral wards, and the result from each polling unit must go into each electoral ward, and a registration at that particular place, the collation officer will collate the results manually. So it is the manual system of a collation that has been creating challenges for the commission. So what we have done is to make sure that as the results are announced at the polling unit, the presiding officer uses the Z-pad and photocopies more or less that particular result sheet, and then it is inputted into a central portal where people can see these results in real time. So what we have is that Nigerians are able, in a very, very transparent manner, to see what goes on at the polling unit before the results even get to the collation center. So if what has been transmitted into the central portal is different from what is being collected, Nigerians will know. So what we have done is to hand over the electoral system to the Nigerian people. And so people are doing their own timetable, people are doing their own collation, and that is the beauty of the Z-pad. So it ensures some level of transparency in results transmission and collation system.
Okay, and that also takes me to maybe two questions in one now. Did this Z-pad help in any way the pace of the result that was released? Because I was actually shocked that INEC beat me to it. I was expecting the result to run into, later in the day, that's the second day, but the results came quite on time. Then how are we likely to have that kind of fast pace, knowing that in Ondo State we have some riverine areas?
Well, you know, the terrain, as you pointed out, in the states are completely different. We have the two riverine areas of Ilaje and Esodo in Ondo State. And we have 270 polling units in these areas. And in these areas, we also have over 62 creeks. There may likely be some level of delay in terms of harvesting the results from these two riverine areas. But we are confident that with some of the measures we have put in place and some and the cooperation we have gotten from the Nigerian Navy and the Nigerian Police Force, especially the Marine Police, that will be in a position to harvest the results from these two riverine local governments on time and declare the results of the election on time.
Okay, good. Let's also look at some of the, according to the INEC chairman, he mentioned that about 16 areas need improvement. Looking at what happened in Edo, part of them has to do with logistics. I would seek more clarity on that. He talks about prompt response to card reader glitches. He talks about vote buying. But let's start with logistics. I think you started that discussion, but can you elaborate more on that? How do you intend to handle logistics? You know, making it better than what we had in
Edo. Well, one of the things we have done. Yes. One of the things we have done is that a month to this particular Ondo governorship election, we moved in all the non-sensitive materials to the various local governments. And all these non-sensitive materials have been batched in accordance with the electoral wards or the registration areas. So to that particular extent, I think we are comfortable. All the COVID-19 materials have also been batched in accordance with the electoral wards. The sensitive materials are already in the central bank in Edo State, in Ondo State. And these materials will move to the local governments tomorrow. So all the political parties, civil society groups and organizations, and the media, and other interested Nigerians will be at the central bank tomorrow to see the methods of distribution and the mode of distribution of these sensitive materials to the various local governments. And the materials have already been batched in accordance with the electoral wards or registration areas, right from the printers. So in terms of that, we are not going to have problems. But what we have done is to also hold bigger discussion with the National Union of Road Transport Workers and the individual transporters to make sure that they sleep at the registration area centers a day before the election, so that at the first light, they can move to the pulley unit. Because what happens is that sometimes we have problem with the transporters arriving late. So we have tried to plug that particular lacuna. Secondly, the issue of the payment of ad hoc staff training allowances. We have also instructed all the electoral officers to make sure that all the ad hoc staff are paid their training allowance a day before deployment, so that on the day of the deployment, we are not going to have challenges with the issue of deployment. And now on the issue of the smart card readers and the type of glitches we had, we have trained additional 104 registration area technical assistants who can intervene at short notice when there's a smart card reader glitch to either restore the smart card reader to good health or to replace the said smart card reader. So we have enough redundancies in all the registration areas. So we don't expect any major challenge with the smart card readers because we have taken the issue of glitches into consideration in the training of both the registration area technical assistants and the ad hoc staff for this election.
Let's still look at some of these issues that you intend to work on, to improve on. For me, I think the major one, and I must say that each time INEC tries to outsmart the kind of electoral malpractices, the riggers come up with another strategy. You remember the menace of vote buying when it came into the political lingo. What you did was to say that don't take your phone, don't do this. But we've seen a comeback of this menace. How do you intend to handle that?
You know, if you ask me, I will say that one of the things we must do as Nigerians, one of the things that civil society groups and organizations must do, one thing that the media must also do, is also to focus attention on the political elite and the political class and the ways and means through which they try to retard the progress of our electoral process and the progress of our democracy. Because in issue of vote buying, if there's nobody who is ready to buy votes, there won't be anybody who is ready to sell. So in this type of transaction, there's a vote buyer and there's a vote seller. So one of the things we must do is to enlighten our people better so that they will know that vote buying and vote selling can only retard our march towards a sustainable democracy. Secondly, we have imputed the ICPC and the EFCC into our Interagency Consultative Committee on Election Security. So on election day, you are going to have plainclothes security agents or plainclothes security personnel parading some of the polling units to make sure that nobody and no group compromises the sanctity of the polling unit. But we're also going to recalibrate our polling unit to ensure the secrecy of the vote. And we're also going to insist that people cannot go into the polling units with their smartphones and their cameras and so on and so forth. And so we keep on improving in relation to that particular area. But we need more sensitization, more voter education, and also we need to continue to appeal to the political elite not to compromise our electoral process by trying to buy off the voters or buy off the conscience of people.
Okay, Mr. Okoye, I must agree with you that it's shameful that we're having this kind of discussion. And I might just stay on this for the next 2-3 minutes before we come back to the election proper. This issue of vote buying, there are conversations around, should we have a special court to try these politicians who are selling this? Or how best would you suggest that this can also be taken? I know that you are acting within the ambit of the law, talking about the INEC now. So what exactly, as a Nigerian first now, because I'm thinking you have the platform to make this suggestion, how do we get this thing nipped in the bud? Because what is obtainable now is they even pay them before the election. So their cameras and confirming their thing may not even apply now. So what's your suggestion beyond what we have now?
Well, I think that the time has come for us to break the cycle of impunity in this country. I was a member of the Electoral Reform Committee, otherwise known as the Waste Committee. I was also at the 2014 National Conference. And we had made this suggestion over and over. that one of the things we need in this country is an electoral offenses commission and tribunal to deal with the issue of arrest, to deal with the issue of investigation, and also to deal with the issue of prosecution. And that in dealing with this, we must also find ways and means of establishing what I call mobile electoral courts on election day, to try people instantly who commit electoral offenses. Because one of the challenges we have is that some of the security agencies that work on election or who are on election duty on election day are drawn from the contiguous states. Some will come from Kogi, some will come from Edo, and so on and so forth. And the moment they finish, they will leave back to their unit. So when people are arrested on grounds of having committed electoral offenses, by the time investigations are completed, by the time arrests are made, and by the time prosecution starts, some of these security personnel have already gone back to their various stations. So getting them to come and give evidence and getting them to come and take that document becomes a very, very huge challenge. So at the end of the day, persons who are arrested on allegation or suspicion of having committed electoral offenses on election day are discharged for lack of diligent prosecution. And then so we keep on recycling impunity in the system. So I think that we must, as a people and as a nation, get the National Assembly to accelerate action on the Electoral Offenses Commission and Tribunal so that we can have a separate and independent agency that will handle the issue of arrest, the issue of investigation, the issue of prosecution, and also the issue of research into why we are where we are. So I believe that that is the right way to go, and that is the right thing to do.
Okay, thank you so much for that. I think it's something what talking about from time to time, and we will also stay more on that on our special broadcast on election day. But let's move on to some other important thing, and that has to do one of them has to do with the COVID-19 protocols. While Edo election received a lot of thumbs up, that seems to be some bit of setback. What is different this time around?
Well, I completely agree with you that the type of response, the type of compliance we expected in relation to the observance of the COVID-19 protocols and guidelines in Edo State was not what we got. Yes, there was compliance in so many of the polling units, and also there was non-compliance in also in several polling units. Now, what we have done is that with the collaboration of the Presidential Task Force on COVID-19, we got infrared thermometers that will serve all the polling units in Edo State. We have also moved all these infrared thermometers to Ondo State. So we are going to use them on election day. Secondly, we have made it very clear that anybody who does not have a face mask or a face covering should not even approach the polling units for the purposes of voting. But one of the lessons we have harvested from Edo is that when the polling unit does not open on time, and when the voters get to the polling unit before the ad hoc staff, there's always a surge. And before the ad hoc staff are able to set up the polling unit and get people to comply with the COVID-19 protocols and guidelines, it becomes difficult. So what we have done and what we have instructed is that our ad hoc staff must go to the polling units at the first light so that they can set up the polling units, get the inner cordon set up, get the outer cordon set up, and also do the demarcation that will make for physical distancing at the polling unit. And then also try to address the voters and urge them to observe both physical distancing and also obey all the security agencies and all the ad hoc staff that will be conducting this election. But you see, in Edo State, what we notice is that when people get into the inner cordon, they put on the face mask, then they cast their votes, and then they step out from the inner cordon, and they remove the mask. So I think that we need to do more enlightenment. We need to do more sensitization. We need to continue to appeal to our people not to endanger their health, because we must vote in safety, and our people must not get sick on account of having gone to the polling units to exercise their democratic franchise. And so we'll continue to appeal to our people to comply with all the COVID-19 protocols and guidelines Because that's the way to go. And that is what we need to do. And that is the right thing to do.
And this might be my last question, and if possible, the second to the last question. And that has to do with my opinion, which I have noticed. I realized that as INEC is improving on electronic way of doing things, the elections are becoming more credible. So my question is, how realistic is electronic voting in Anambra State? Because you were quoted to have said that there's no going back on electronic voting in Anambra 2021. Were you misquoted? And how realistic is this?
No, I was not misquoted. You can see that this particular commission is irrevocably determined to deepen the use of technology in our electoral process. And you can see that with the Nasarawa Central State Constituency election, with the Edo governorship election, and with this Edo governorship election, you can see that more and more we are embracing technology and we are using technology in our electoral process. All the political parties file the list and particulars of their nominated candidates electronically into a dedicated portal. All the civil society groups and organizations apply for accreditation electronically. The media apply for accreditation electronically. And so we have embraced technology and we are going to continue in that particular direction. And you can also see that the results of this particular of these elections are also being uploaded electronically. And so we are going to move in that direction. It is a commitment to use electronic voting machines for the 2021 Anambra governorship election. And in order to kickstart that, we have done several surveys, and we have invited 40 companies to come and do some level of demonstration on what they can offer and the type of technological solution they can offer. 8 of those companies have already done demonstrations. And so at the end of the day, we will look at all the solutions that have been proffered. And then we look at the one that is reliable. We look at the one that we can trust. We look at the one that is sustainable, and also look at the one that takes into consideration our environment, takes into consideration the verification and authentication process, and also the voting process. And so we are going to harvest all these things and make sure that we get the one that is best for the country. And coterminous with that, we're also working with the National Assembly to amend the electoral legal framework to accommodate all the this new direction we are going. So we are confident that we are in the right direction, and we are confident that the Nigerian people are with us, and we're also confident that we can pull it through.
Thank you so much, Mr. Festus Okoye, for your time. I know it's been a very busy period for you, but wish you all the best and better outcome in Ondo State governorship election. Thank you once again. And to our viewers, thank you for staying with us. We'll take a short break now and we'll come up with a report. But when we return, we hear from the side of either Senator Olujimi or Governor Makinde as regards the tension in PDP Southwest. We'll be back.